And that's it. So I want you to join me in welcoming our very own Gaye LeBaron.
Thank you, Mike. I too want to thank the 6th Street Playhouse. You know, we want to talk about history. We've come a long, long way in theater in the last 40 years. It's right. Not me, I got a handicap plate. It's the only good thing about arthritis, let me tell you. Okay, yes. The reason I called you all together here is to talk about history, to talk about Santa Rosa history. Now, as you know, history is a very serious business, no doubt about it. We don't make light of the Black Plague, or the Inquisition, or Hitler, or the centuries of assassinations, massacres, and terrorism, the evils, as Hamlet would say, that flesh is heir to, the things we don't want to remember. But it isn't all like that. There are so many things we don't want to forget. Tyrants toppled, freedoms won, the stories of great men and women who have invented and argued and fought and improved the human condition and altered the course of history. And then there's nostalgia, which is another way not to forget. That's defined by Webster as a wistful desire to return in thought or fact to a former time in one's life, a sentimental journey. Now Wikipedia, which is always anxious to impress, goes well beyond Webster in defining nostalgia, a Greek compound word consisting of nostos meaning homecoming and algos meaning pain or ache. In less clinical usage, nostalgia refers to a general interest in the past and their personalities and events, especially the good old days from one's earlier life. Now, this kind of nostalgia is the kind that I used to foster in the form of a gimmicky game called Old Older. And it's the kind of thing that tonight we're calling quirky, offbeat, even silly, maybe. And it may come from a word meaning pain or ache, but nostalgia seems most often to be the things that make us smile, or even laugh out loud when we remember, maybe because they seem so strange to us now. They didn't then. Well, some of them did. But if you were a teenager in Santa Rosa in the 1940s, your triggers would be things like the Wink and Lantern, or the Wink as they called it, or the milkshakes at Bouck's, or the joy of being declared old enough to ride the little yellow bus downtown to the children's library. In the 50s, we drove around the courthouse, cruised forth, gathered at Gordon's Drive-In or the Eat and Run. Scarf and barf, I believe. Teenage girls wore dish towels for scarves and bobby socks, and boys wore Levi's styled as hip hangers and Hawaiian shirts and DAs. And if you don't know what DA means, you're either too young or too old. Dutch Floor was the police chief, and he ran the town like a benevolent dictator. He was known to put a giant hand on a kid's shoulder, maybe you've had that happen to you, some of you, and hand him a dollar bill and tell him to go get a haircut. And he was the law west of the Pecos, there was no doubt about it. The 60s was the coffee house era, La Bottega on Santa Rosa Avenue, run by Ted Binkley and Gus Bouchard. Gus Bouchard, incidentally, went on to become the chancellor of the California junior college system. I just thought you might like to know that. There was later a bookstore and a coffee house there called the Apex, which Chief Floor viewed with even more suspicion than he viewed Bottega. He thought perhaps, maybe, that something called marijuana was changing hands among the customers. Now, out of all these times came some good stories. true stories. Some of them that now seem stranger than fiction. There's always some universals, things that people that all of us of a certain age remember, but not always in the same way. And I think Pepper is a good place to start. Yeah. How many of you remember Pepper? I should have said how many don't. Well, there's a quirky history for you. Pepper, her real name, well, it depends on what day you asked her. I have only two names to offer. They would be surnames. Her maiden name was Garcia, her married name was Darden. But if you asked for her real first name, sometimes you got Florence, sometimes you got Linda, sometimes something else. But it was always followed by, don't call me that, call me Pepper. And it wasn't a request, it was an order. She was born in Salinas. She had relatives in King City who wanted nothing to do with her at all, and I know that because I contacted them on her behalf when her husband died. She had been at Sonoma State Hospital since childhood, and she was released in 1942, or right about there, when many of the high-functioning patients were allowed to go into the community if they could find work. Pepper hired on as a housekeeper for a Santa Rosa family, and then she met and married Paul Darden, a tall, shambling, good-natured guy, who was a janitor at the Occidental Hotel on B Street. And they lived in a rented house on Humboldt behind Stone's Furniture. In the 50s and 60s, you could see them walking down the street hand in hand, Paul in his bib overalls and Pepper in her bright red dress, or her red pebble pushers and Hawaiian shirt and her moccasins with the shiny bows in her shiny black hair, and occasionally a beauty mark or two on her cheek made from those gold stars that the teachers used to give you for good behavior. In 1967, she added a town marshal's badge to her costume, and that was the result of a called-off shootout in Old Courthouse Square, or in Courthouse Square, between a Montgomery Village businessman named, he was a pest control guy, and his name was something like Bugsy something, I can't remember, and Bob Torvik, who was a downtown automobile dealer, and the winner was to be the town marshal. Now, I don't remember why it was called off, but it was, and it was decided to give the honor to Pepper. She took it very seriously. And she began to rail even louder at jaywalkers and flashed it when she was asked by storekeepers, please not to yodel in the store. Now, once we had a transit system in place, she extended her territory to Cottingtown. And she hung out mostly at Orange Julius there. I don't remember her much in the village. I don't know whether she wasn't welcome or just didn't get that far, but yodeling, helping herself, she yodeled all up and down, and she yodeled on the radio with Jim Grady on occasion, just like on Mother's Day she sang M is for the many things you, whatever it is, and on Halloween she yodeled and she sang Christmas carols for Grady at the appropriate time. And she also went from drugstore to drugstore, and there were like 6 or 7 pharmacies on 4th Street and 5th Street, which is pretty hard to imagine now. But she would go from one perfume counter to the other, helping herself to all the scents, and you could smell her coming a mile away. She hollered at jaywalkers constantly. She loved telling jokes, her jokes to pedestrians, you know, like, hey lady, you dropped something, that was a favorite. And when you stopped and looked behind you, she'd yell, your footprints, and then she'd just laugh like a hyena. Pepper stories are everywhere. Everybody who ever saw her had one. I remember her when there was a PG&E crew at 5th and Mendocino, and they had the manhole open. And she was coming along, and there was somebody down the manhole. You could see the ladder, and somebody working down there, and she bent down, and she yelled into that, hey, down there. And this guy came up, and I swear, his eyes were just going around. She collected for charities. She, White Canes, the Lions White Cane Day, she was always on side. And at one time, there actually became a crisis because the Lions decided she was too aggressive and that they weren't going to let her do it anymore. And I think they rescinded that. But she was aggressive. She would holler after those who didn't didn't buy one or didn't put money in the pot, you know, hey, jungle boy, come back here and put some money in this. And, you know, I got to know her better than most. When Paul died in 1967, the town raised some money, a collection that we called the Pepper Pot, to sustain her until a couple of leading citizens, really leading citizens, Bob Bishop from Bishop Ford, which was downtown then, who administered her funds, and her doctor, Bill Rudy, who arranged for her to be declared unemployable and eligible for a state pension. And after that, Pepper lived alone for more than 20 years. She patrolled the streets, kept law and order until her legs gave out, and she went to live in the Petaluma rest home. And in all those 20 years, she wrote stories, which she gave to her friends, written on yellow legal pads and illustrated with tiny drawings in colored pencils. And I've got a whole file of those in my archive down at Sonoma State, the one she wrote to me, big stacked, and the one she wrote to Helen Rudy, whom she considered her mommy because Bill Rudy, her husband, was her daddy. And it was all about her cat Spunky and her kittens. And Spunky and her kittens had amazing adventures. They went to Africa. They visited President Nixon in the White House. And you know, if you think about Pepper as being less than smart, she wrote a good, clear hand. She was, you know, lucid and did pretty well with her stories. I have, you know, and she's always said, and she would say it somewhere in the middle, in parentheses, you know, this isn't true. These are just lies. And I thought that gave a whole new dimension to the genre that we call fiction. Pepper died in 1992, and the last time I saw her was at Christmas. And I went down to see her in this care home in Petaluma where she was. You couldn't walk anymore. And I took her a poinsettia. And as I was leaving, we had a little visit, and as I was leaving, I started down the hall, and she yelled at me, "Hey, lizard." So I stopped, and I went back. And she said, "You ever make those things with marshmallows and Rice Krispies?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I used to when the kids were little." She said, "Well, next time, bring those instead." Piece of work. My favorite Pepper story remains the one that was told to me by her doctor friend, Bill Rudy. He had a convertible in the early 1950s, and of course, she caught up with him driving along 4th Street, and she piled in and asked for a ride home. The top was down. And as they started off, she climbed up on the back and started giving the queen wave going all the way down 4th Street. And he just drove along, praying that no one would recognize him. Well, years later, he told that story at a dinner party on Montecito Heights at a friend's house in a fancy home with some of the town's leading citizens at the table. And he told the story of his patient who insisted on doing her queen wave from his convertible, and he left the name to be the punchline. And when he said, "Maybe you know her, her name was Pepper," everyone at the table laughed except the admiral's wife, who leaned across the table to her husband to ask in all earnestness, "Dear, do we know the Peppers?" You had to live very high on the hill. There was another woman in Santa Rosa in those years that we remember in quite a different light. Let me tell you a quick today story. About a month ago, I got a letter at the office from a Windsor woman who told me that she had found and purchased a photo album from the Salvation Army's treasure table up at Lytton, and she thought it might be somebody important and asked if I would like to look at it. I called her, and subsequently, I had a nice visit from Ruby Parsley, a 90-year-old who stopped by my house on her way home from her line dancing class. And she brought me a very thick photo album, about like this, of photos of Gladys Barnes. Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow. And those of you who don't know Gladys Barnes, how about if I said Mother Witch? But Barnes was born October 11th, 1922 in Oakland, and her single mother died shortly after she was born and left her an orphan, and she moved from foster home to foster home, really celebrating, you know, never really celebrating her birthday or holidays. And that's why holidays, traditions were so important to her. When she moved to Santa Rosa in 1946 and married Ben Barnes, who was a chauffeur and a gardener, who was the love of her life, and they lived in South Park on the corner of Temple and Ware Street. They had a big yard. And when they first arrived here in 47, Ben was doing chauffeur duty for those who required a driver. He did yard work. And later, when his uptown clients entertained, he would put on a white coat, set up the bar, and pour the drinks. He was, as you can imagine, indispensable. And on Halloween 1948, just after they were married, pretty much on a whim, Ben drove out in his big old wooden station wagon, and he gathered up the children of the people that he worked for, and he brought them home where he and Gladys had decorated the garage for Halloween. And Gladys was a tall, lean, sharp-featured woman, and she greeted them in a superbly frightening witch getup. There were 8 children that year. The next year, Ben and Gladys, another witch, she told the children, expanded, and they filled bags with apples and popcorn balls and candy for the neighborhood kids. And you know how word gets around in a town that's not too big. The party list grew, and by the late 1950s, Gladys was holding monthly rummage sales to raise funds for the party. And then the community began to help. Merchants donated, volunteers came to marshal the children, now numbering more than 1,000 by 1960. By the late 60s, some 4,500 children were filling the barn's big corner lot, overflowing the house and the garage. How many of you went to Gladys's house on Halloween? Anybody? My kids did, I remember. I mean, we took them down. In the 70s, Gladys went airborne, flying in the sheriff's helicopter. And the attendance was now more than 12,000. And the Rotary Club and the Citizens Band Radio Club and the Army Reserves were all working on the project. And the police came happily to direct traffic, since vandalism in town decreased proportionately with the increase in attendance. Ben and Gladys were Santa Rosa's Citizens of the Year in 1977. They received state honors from Governor Ronald Reagan. The South Park Halloween party went on for 37 years until Ben became ill. And even then it continued in a much more restrained fashion. Gladys changed the venue to the Creekside Convalescent Hospital on Sonoma Avenue, where Ben was a patient. And she put on her peaked hat and black cloak every Halloween and let it be known that Mother Witch, with the help of the hospital staff, would hand out candy to the neighborhood kids. Ben died in 1987 when Gladys worked as a caregiver, but she continued to visit the patients of Creekside. And when she herself became ill in the 90s, she marshaled the staff of the Summerfield Convalescent Home where she lived to make trick-or-treat bags for the kids in that neighborhood, and she even got out her old witch's hat. She died in 2002, and somehow that thick photo album of her earlier years, no Mother Witch photos, but photos of family and friends, ended up in a flea market bargain basement, and Ruby Parsley, great name, mother, I said, it's a great name. She said, I know, Rosemary Sage and Thyme. Ruby said, I just knew she was somebody. And she was right. Now, claiming personal privilege, I want to talk a bit about my Santa Rosa, the town that I first knew when I came here. That would be the 1950s. The Gordon's drive-in years, the foreign films at the Tower Theater. Boy, did we think we were fancy. The drive around the courthouse, and around and around. And if you wanted to really take a chance, you went by late at night backward to see if the police were awake. Right by the police station. Rosenberg's in the White House, the Topaz Room, Eisenhood's, Wright's Coffee Shop with the world's best strawberry pie, and a new place called Max Delicatessen. And these were still the Dutch floor years. It's interesting with all the controversy now surrounding law enforcement to look back at the floor years. Not necessarily you understand with any realization or wish to return. Dutch was a very good man, but the times were very different. We reporters like to say that he ran a clean town, but he never heard of a civil liberty. What Dutch said went, and fortunately, as I said, he was a good man. In the 1950s, when I began my long march with the Press Democrat, there were 14, maybe 15 police officers in Santa Rosa. The police station was on the ground floor of the old City Hall on Hinton Avenue, between the Topaz Room and the county jail. It was a homespun sort of police department. Reporters were welcome to walk behind the counter, look at the daily log, exchange pleasantries with the dispatchers, ask questions, and get answers. And if there was something in the log that looked like it might be a story, we were welcome to dig into the basket and find the report. And I don't have to tell you, in today's world of criminal justice, it doesn't work that way. And there are all kinds of legal reasons why not. In the 1990s, I had a conversation with a retired officer who had worked in the late 40s and 50s. And he told me about the day he took a marijuana cigarette from a transient, and he showed it to Dutch. And they talked it over, and they decided they needed to know more about this. So they took some of the seeds to the flower shop on Santa Rosa Avenue, right there by the bridge, and they asked Tony Campiglia, the owner, to plant them and grow a couple of plants. And when they were 4 or 5 inches high, my detective friend said, he took them to a meeting of the Sonoma County Peace Officers Association and passed them around so the officers would recognize a pot plant when they saw it. They'd never seen one before. Now, no subject can touch law enforcement for amazing stories of days gone by. Hopefully, one day soon, the Historical Society of Santa Rosa, who is member, Smokey Sverko, who was a retired policeman, real name is Rodney, we'll talk about his adventures in the 60s, and he has stories to tell. The tales that I have heard are from officers earlier than that. I'm sorry to say long gone, but the stories still make me laugh out loud. One story takes place in a bar called the Sport Club. The owner called police at 2 o'clock closing to help him with a patron that refused to leave. He'd been sitting there all night, the bartender complained, with his elbows on the plank and his face resting on his hands, and as it turned out, he was dead. The officer I talked to, his name was Carl Meister, and Carl said, the guy was cement. Solid as a rock, he'd been dead for hours. He said they called the coroner and they had laid him on the stretcher. He was in the same shape. They couldn't flatten him out. And that's just one of many adventures. One involves a businessman with a reputation for, as shall we say, an imbiber. He was out on the town and he ran out of money, so he went to his store on B Street, opened the safe, took out some cash and slammed the door, and it was a double door safe, and he caught his tie in it up close. Fortunately for him, a foot patrolman making the rounds after the bars closed saw the light on and checked. And the officer found a pair of scissors and cut the tie off. Tell him I'll call him back. Called for a car and took him home. And this guy is the same guy who was involved in my favorite 4th of July story. In the day when fireworks were legal and much more explosive, there was a liquor store owner on 4th Street that sold them every year. And he had a window display full of rockets and crackers and cherry bombs and the like. And our friend went in there to buy a pint. And on the way out, he passed the window display and tossed in a cigarette butt. A cigar butt, I think it was. It blew out the window. It sent rockets into the air. The poor store owner, who happened to have been a World War I veteran who had been in the Lost Battalion, dropped down to his knees and then his stomach and did a combat crawl under the swinging half doors that led to the saloon next door. It was spectacular. Just spectacular. Our friend came back the next day and paid for the damage, but the story never went away. Now, it's interesting to think about what an alcoholic society it was here 50 years ago. There were 30 bars between E Street and the railroad, mostly on 3rd, 4th, and 5th. And they ran the gamut from the fancy schmancy Topaz Room, which, with its original owners, was posted off limits to enlisted men during World War II. Only officers could go to the Topaz Room. And then there were places like the Squirrel Cage, which my husband used to refer to as a real armpit barn. It was across A Street from the post office. And, you know, the we cash paycheck signs were prominently displayed the closer you got to the tracks. But there were outliers as well. Some of them were far out, like Sonia's on Porter Creek Road, beyond Mark West Lodge. And that was a favorite hangout for JC people, despite the torturous road back down the mountain. And the Boots and Saddles, actually at the corner of Brush Creek Road, where the regulars had beer mugs with their names on them. And for the sporting crowd, there was, and still is, as far as I know, the 440 Club, where in those days, Norm Maroney, the owner, was also a font of local baseball lore and the manager of the beloved Santa Rosa Rosebuds. I've left out a couple of dozen. You can make your own list. But I do have to say something about Place. Where Hank's is now, at Farmer's Lane and 4th Street, that was Clay's. It was built originally as the old Trail Inn in the Depression years, and believe it or not, it was a tea room. And Clay Williams bought it in the 40s. And Clay was from a pioneer family. His grandfather, James Williams, owned the first water company and was known as Bridge Williams because he lived by a bridge over a creek that then flowed, now think about this, flowed east to west just north of St. Rose Church. It's probably still under there. A long, long time ago. But you do wonder where it went, don't you? I do. But I digress here. Bridge Williams' grandson, Clay, ran a museum-quality bar. Best tradition of the Old West. It had traditional deer heads, maybe a moose, I don't remember. Probably one of those jackalopes that all the old bars used to treasure. You know, the rabbit with the antlers. And Clay's son, Ray Williams, who retired from the forestry in Del Norte County, wrote me many letters a dozen years ago, reminiscing about the town he grew up in, he was 81 then, and sharing stories about his father's cabin. And he talked about the old boxing pictures and the posters on the wall. And I remember Clay's. I was in there when I wasn't old enough to drink like everybody else. But I don't remember all of these things, but he lined them up for me. Some trophies that belonged to a famous rodeo queen, a piece of the safety net used in the construction of the Golden Gate Bridge that broke, killing several workers as it went down. A piece of the rope believed to have been used in the 1920 lynching here. The first bell used to chime the time at radio station KSRO, which was the first station north of the bay. A whale harpoon. A bull cane made out of, as Ray put it, a bull's you know what. A cap and ball. A cap and ball rifle, I'm sorry, dug up near Fort Ross, several bear traps, and a decorated Christmas tree hanging upside down from the ceiling all year round. Ray told me about cowboys who rode their horses over from the fairgrounds and right into the bar, about the skeet chutes out the back windows. Sometimes the targets were empty whiskey bottles tossed into Santa Rosa Creek, about shooting water rats in the creek to see who paid for the next round. He also told about the county official who drove the sheriff around to the bars about once a month. Ray thought it was probably the way the sheriff relieved the tension of the job. Claude Worthington was the bartender, an old Navy guy with lots of very interesting tattoos. Everybody who was old enough in the 50s and early 60s, or even close, tall enough to put a nickel on the bar, some said, remembered Clayton's. The late Jim Benefield, who grew up in Mill Valley, was a speaker at the funeral of his Cal fraternity brother, Will Parsons. And he reminisced about the first time he came home with Will and he went to a bar. He said it was an amazing place on the creek called Clint's. And before he could finish the sentence, a murmur started running through the funeral home, which was crowded with all of these Santa Rosa born and raised friends of Will's. And they kept saying, Clint's. They whispered it to each other. He means Clayton's. And the murmur rose. It was like waves pounding on the shore. And none of us ever let Benefield forget it. And everybody had a Clayton story to tell. My dear friend, Nina Arabet, remembers that she had been patronizing Clayton's for a year or more. And she was a favorite of Claude the bartender when she ran for Miss Sonoma County. And the story in the PD included her age, which was 18. Yeah. That night she wandered in with a group of friends and Claude handed her a beer. I saw your picture in the paper, he said, better take that back into the back room and drink it. Finally, there's an older tale told about a prominent lawyer, maybe the most prominent in town, who was known as, we should say, a bon vivant. There had been an accident, and someone had driven a car into the front wall of Clayton's, and the lawyer, who was defending the driver, was questioning a woman witness at the trial. When did you leave Clayton's, he asked her. Right after they threw you out, sir, she said. Ah, lawyer stories. Well, now that's another subject, but for another day. And I wanted to leave time, and I have, for you to talk about what you want to talk about or ask me what you want me to try to talk about. And I can barely see you, so wave your hands. Yes? Dokes, yeah?
Dokes?
Yeah. Dokes, toot, and dope. Things you miss. Okay, anybody else got things they miss?
I missed the joke shop next to the bank.
The what?
The joke shop next to the bank.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
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 Yeah. Anybody else? How about pepper stories? Somebody must have pepper stories. Yes. Oh, the crystal ball. That crystal. That's in the 70s. Now you're getting up into... Sal Razzano is here somewhere, and I promised him I wouldn't talk about the 70s. No, that... Yeah, the running fence, of course, that was a huge adventure for all of Sonoma County, and one of those things where we all thought, what in the world is this about when we first heard about it, and then everybody was quite taken with it. One of our great adventures. Pepper story? Yeah, go. The police were really good to Pepper. That whole era police department, they gave her rides home, they looked after her. And when Paul died, the police department came in full uniform in their white gloves and served as pallbearers. And Stan Lance from Egan and Lance provided the funeral and drove the limousine himself. So the town, you know, I always said, a lot of people, of course, hated Pepper. You know that. I mean, you've got to know that. And I used to get letters from people that was just, you know, why do you keep writing about this pain in the neck, you know? And I used to say, and I still do, that any town that can't have a town character is too big.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I don't know, but what we haven't gotten there. Yes.
So one day I'm waiting for Don to come home, and I said, "Well, Pepper just got in the car. The door was locked." Pepper got in the car. I said, "And?" He said, "Well, she made me stop and while she went grocery shopping." She went around, and she called him Red because he had red hair.
And she always wanted to come home with me and do my ironing, but somehow I managed to get out of that one. But I was in her house, and it was as neat as a pin. Yeah. All kinds of knickknacks. Possibly shoplifted. There's a possibility of it. Anybody else? Anybody have a police story they want to talk about? Hmm? Okay, go.
Back in the 50's, the cops always carried a little 6-inch stick. How old was your car? Oh, about 8 inches.
Oh, yeah.
Put that stick under the car. You better bring that car back tomorrow. Over 8 inches.
The straight pipes. There's a story about Gordon's drive-in and straight pipes, and the people, you know, everybody's car was lowered and had pipes, and they would go out and rap out, and the police would go after them. And there was a policeman, as I remember, whose name, he was the first motorcycle policeman, I think, in Santa Rosa. The Rat, right. His name was Homer Lee, and they called him the Rat. And there is a story which I cannot substantiate, because the police at the time didn't want to talk about it, that some people, some gentleman, younger gentleman, he used to park across 4th Street from Gordon's Drive-In and wait until, and in those days you could drive through from College Avenue to 4th Street through the drive-in, and people did a lot. And he would wait across 4th Street for them to come out and rap out with their pipes, and then he would go after them and give them a ticket. And somebody went up and talked to him and engaged him while two others chained his motorcycle to a telephone pole. Now, I say this is unsubstantiated, but the story goes that then of course, they went back to Gordon's, got in the car, and came roaring out of the driveway, and he jumped on the accelerator, upended, and broke his collarbone. But that's, if, you know, I can't say that's true. Yes?
Well, I had the good fortune of working in the evenings at Wright's Coffee Shop. And the owner then was Neil Hudson. Yeah. And I was my first week there, and I was working at night. And Neil came back, and he said, "The custom here is we close at 10. I want a cup of coffee, and I want a piece of pie."
Strawberry? Was it strawberry?
You know, I think it was. I couldn't remember if it was strawberry or cherry or something. And it always had to be at the back door just inside. And sure enough, at closing time, would come in a Santa Rosa police officer. Back then, they wore a khaki uniform. And he would have pie and coffee while Neil counted out the money.
Yeah, and I interviewed, I think it was Lee Gleason and George Cinto and a number of policemen, Carl Meister, and this was common, and they went up and down, they rattled doors, they made sure everything was locked up. I mean, and it was a, you know, we don't have foot patrol anymore, but it was an interesting time. There's a wonderful story that Meister told about getting a call at the office from somebody in the junior college neighborhood who said that they had a prowler. They had somebody in the alley that they thought was trying to get into the house. So two guys went out there with a patrol car, and they went down the alley, and they picked up a couple of teenagers who were just putting their shoes back on, and they ascertained that they had that they were trying to do some breaking and entering if they could find a house that was empty. So they called another car and they took those kids in, and then they took off their ties and their hats, and they turned their lights off in the car, and they drove very slowly around the neighborhood, and this is like 2 in the morning, just going very softly on the horn, beep, 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 and pretty soon a kid comes running down the alley in his stocking feet and jumps in the back seat of the car. It was like, surprise. Anybody else have anything they want to?
I have a question.
Yeah.
How was Alfred Hitchcock received by Santa Rosa?
Oh, they loved him. Now we're talking about Shadow of the Doubt.
Yes, yeah.
In 1942, they loved him. He was filming on McDonald Avenue, and he made friends with Don Geary, who was the judge, who lived just up the street. And he and Geary would sit out on the porch or the veranda at Geary's house, so he could watch all of his equipment, which was set up out there, and they would have their long cocktail hour every night. No, he was very well, and the town just went absolutely ape over. I mean, I sound like I was there, but I just read the stories over Joseph Cotton, particularly. He was the society editor, Birdweiler Kellogg, just thought he was the handsomest man she'd ever seen, and she wrote stories about how he went out to Howarth Park, which now Howarth Park was then what we call Burbank Park, next to Burbank Elementary School. And there was down at the cookhouse end, there was a tennis court. And he came dressed all in white to play tennis. And Birdweiler Kellogg, her tongue was hanging out. So, yeah, they were, I don't think Teresa Wright ever came here. I think all of her scenes were filmed
she was
here?
She was.
You remember? Oh, yeah, she was from here. I talked to somebody else who was in her class who said the thing they really remembered was she went to Hollywood for some of the filming and came back and she had a fake fur coat. And everybody
she
was...
She had the first, what we call, teddy bear coats.
Yeah.
And it was brown with the embroidered piece down the front. But the real part of her costume were the red...
Wow. She probably could have sold those to Pepper. You know, Edna Mae Wanacott is still around. And there's somebody writing a book about Hitchcock who's coming to Santa Rosa, I don't remember when, just sometime in October. And, I mean, he's coming just passing through, but he had already, we've been emailing back and forth, and he had visited with Edna Mae Wanacott. I think she lives in either Arizona or New Mexico and had a nice visit. She was in Paradise for a while, up that way. But now she's down south.
Do you have any stories about the grocery bus?
The grocery bus? You mean like Aragonese? Was he delivering or was he selling?
Selling.
I'll be darned. No, I've never heard about that.
Go out the back, get produce, popsicles.
There you go.
That was before they were in cellophane. They were open-ended, you know.
About that time, Nella Fratty had...
Nella Fratty had the fish truck. Yeah, I remember that. And I'd never heard of Frank. I've heard of Mr. Benincasa and his... Benincasa. Yeah. Yes. Well, yeah, but that's not Santa Rosa. That's Bodega Bay, and we're in the Santa Rosa. Lots of stories about Hazel Mitchell. In fact, the museum is just getting ready to do a show on the 50th anniversary of the hole in the head of the the power plant that wasn't, and there's a lot of Hazel in that, I'll tell you. She was right out in the forefront. Yes, I do. Sold blankets. Yes, I do. He was from the, wait a minute, give me a, it wasn't Pendleton Woolen Mills, it was somebody? One of the woolen mills, the Utah woolen mills, I think.
We still have some from the JC.
I still have one too, because my mother-in-law bought one for my husband when he first went from the crib to the bed, and that's, my husband passed away in February and he was 85 years old, so you have some idea of what we're talking about. And yes, I remember Jack Frost, and I did a column on him, and John took his picture standing out in front of his car with his dog, and he had kept the samples in the car. And you know, I talked at the time I did the column, I talked to the people at the woolen mills. And they told me that he was the last salesman of that type on the road, and that they kept him there and let him do that because it was so important to him, and he could stay as long as he wanted. Wow. And you know, that's pretty cool. Anybody else?
Yeah,
where? Can't see. I can't see. Ah, there you are. Yes, ma'am. I don't know what happened to it. The one that said the gateway to the Redwood Empire. Yeah, I don't know. We have a lot of things that disappeared. The drinking fountain from in front of the old library, the drinking fountain at the corner of the courthouse. There's all kinds of things that vanish. Somebody's got them. Yeah. Yes, back there.
Hi, do you have any information about Tom Campion?
Oh, Tom Campion was... Yeah, who's that back there?
Jack Ashton.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah, Tom, I'll let you talk, but Tom. Yeah, you've got information there?
Yes, I do.
Good, okay. Tom Campion was a bailiff in the courts, and he, well, you go ahead, you tell him. How many times did the Campions win the National Drill Team Championship?
13 times state, 5 times national. We were on TV in Chicago, LA, Milwaukee. Greatest years of our lives.
Yeah. You couldn't have a parade here hearing those Campions coming down the street. Actually, I remember that, and you look good. Campions were black and white striped shirts, black pants, black boots, and black hats. And your biggest competition was the Half Moon Bay something or other.
Don's,
right, yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, way in the back.
About Ray Radley.
I don't have any anecdotes, but I knew Ray Radley, and he was a great guy. Somebody mentioned Ray Radley to me just the other day, and I don't... Something that he was doing as a volunteer after he left the police
Little
department.
League.
What?
Ray Radley was head of the Little League and Dolls. Later on in life, he and his wife Judy, he was president of California Doll Collectors.
Oh, really? I'll be done. Yeah. Yeah, he was kind of the last of the downtown foot patrol guys.
I have a race story.
You have a race story? Good.
Yeah, I was, my wife and I went to a little sandwich shop on the west side of the square. And I guess as was Ray's habit, at about noon, he'd come in and get a sandwich. And there was a couple, a young couple, having some problems, and they were out in the area there, and they were arguing loudly. And Ray comes in and he orders a sandwich, and sits down at the table, and he's got an eye out there on this, and he gets his sandwich, and you know, there's one thing you hate to do, and that's disturb a cop when it's lunch or dinner. And so finally, the noise gets a little more heated, the yelling rises, Ray neatly takes the napkin, lays it down, and I think, wow, the fireworks are going to start, Ray's going to run out the door. No, Ray goes to the door, opens it a couple of and yells out there in his booming voice, "Let's keep it down, I'm eating."
And they cried right now. That's good.
His shoulders were as wide as a freight train.
Yeah, yeah, he was a big guy. Anybody else?
Over here.
Where? Oh, there you are. Okay, go. Oh, I'm sorry, you're too short. I couldn't see you. No, I was talking to Rick and Rick.
So, any stories about Dr. Mitch Soso?
Dr. Mitch Soso, he was an interesting man. He was a school superintendent for a long time, and I think he was assistant superintendent before that under Dr. Wood, Lloyd K. Wood. Mitch was a guy he was personally a very interesting guy. He came from up in the Motherlode, up around, what's the name of the... Jackson, yeah, that's right. And his family were Serbs or from that part of the country, and he was very proud of his heritage. Interesting man. That's all. I don't have an anecdote about him. I don't tell anecdotes about school principals. Yes. Benny and the Jets? I don't know. I don't know. I missed that one this morning. I'll go back and look. Anybody know? Oh, for heaven's sake. Here. Yeah. Well, of course... lots of people have started here. I mean, no, but I mean, I don't know. That's interesting. Were they coming back? Was that why they asked? Oh, for heaven's sake.
Isn't it Saturday afternoon?
Well, the only good, my favorite Saturday afternoon club story is, and I don't think they do it anymore, but it's been fairly recently that women had always went by their husband's names. When I went there to speak the first time and they asked me to come and talk about something, I don't remember what, they introduced me as Mrs. John LeBaron. And all the women were Mrs. somebody, and if they were divorced, then there was a protocol you followed where you went with your Mrs. and with your married name and your... I remember Roby Gemmel, who was the society editor of the paper, always her formal name was Mrs. Laughlin Gemmel on second reference. Her maiden name was Laughlin. So that on second reference, if you know, you could call me Mrs. John LeBaron, but on second reference, I would be, if I were divorced, which I wasn't, I would be Mrs. Notley LeBaron, which is, you know, weird. But, So far as I know, I think they've gotten over that. And I've been to Saturday Afternoon Club talks fairly recently, and there's a small group that still, you know, that have been there a long time that are still meeting and doing good things. Anybody else? Yes, Mrs. Chairman. I was at the grand opening of the Flamingo Hotel. You heard what?
Something happened with the water.
Yes, the water went off. I mean, it didn't go on when it was supposed to. Yeah, things were a little dicey about the food and the water. But the thing I remember about it, I think it was about the second date I ever had with my husband. So, you know, 1956? Something like that, 57 maybe. Well, they took it down and then they put it back up. Well, I don't think the Flamingo had anything to do with the Cotton County sign. No, I think they took it down. An owner took it down because it needed repair and didn't want to bother with it. But they put it back up, the new owner. But yeah, because the Flamingo went through some hard times in between. And the Cottingtown sign, Hugh actually got it declared a historical landmark. No, I'm serious. He did. And because when they went, for some reason, when they went to find the papers that in the planning department at the city that would indicate how long, when that would have to come out, you know, it had been grandfathered in but could only go so long, those papers had disappeared. So the city declared it a historical landmark. And of course it stopped and then it went and then it stopped and then it went, depending on Hugh's whim. Yeah.
Do you remember the covered wagon in Montgomeryville?
Sure.
You know what happened to it, don't you? It got blown up one night.
It got blown up? Is this an older one than the one that they just took down a couple of
years? Older one, back in the 50s.
Oh, I didn't know about that.
Well, I didn't know about it.
I had nothing to do with it. What did you
think?
Yes, Hanya? In the square? With the, you mean upstairs? The law offices? No, just that that's their offices, still is. That was the Empire building. It was originally a bank. And it was the Bank of America. And then Henry tells a wonderful story in his book about how he happened to buy the Empire building, or how it became the Empire building. It was the Bank of America, and he ran into Joe Lombardi, who was the bank president, or the bank, the local bank manager, and they had just moved over to where Corix is now. They had moved over onto 4th Street, and the bank was empty, and Joe, it was for sale. And Joe Lombardi said, you know anybody who wants to buy the bank? You know, we want, I forget, I don't count, I mean, the figures don't matter, but because I don't remember them. But he said something like, you know, we want $100,000 for it. And Henry said, on a whim, well, I'll give you $80,000 for it if you'll give me a $70,000 loan. And Lombardi said, well, that's not going to happen. And he walked, you know, snickered and left. And then he called him about a week later and said, were you serious about that? And Henry said, well, only if you can get the provision removed that I can't put any financial institution in there. And he said, oh, that'll never happen. And Henry said, well, it's off. And then in a week later, he called back again and said, I think we can do that. So then Henry had this building that needed repairs and didn't know what to do with it. So he talked to a woman who had the business college, a little business college here, and said, if you come to work for me, you can move, let's put a business college in there. And that was the beginning of Empire Business College, which Henry's wife named the Empire Building. And of course, that's been a huge success. Somebody asked Henry what his proudest accomplishment was. And he said he knew it wasn't a charitable thing, you know, but he was proudest of Empire College because so many people had gotten a different slant on life there. Okay, anybody else?
Have you ever thought of publishing Pepper's story?
Well, I think, I don't know how good a read they would be, but because, you know, I mean, they're rambling on about Spunky and her kittens. It's, huh?
It's my kind of story.
Your kind of story. I don't know what the copyright is on that. I'd have to figure that out. I guess she gave them to me, they're mine. Well, I think we've come to where we need to go out and have a glass of wine and talk it over among ourselves. Thank you so much. This has been really fun. Before you go, I wanted to add just a little bit about to what Mike said about the Historical Society of Santa Rosa. You know, this is something that I just think is a great idea. I don't know whether you realize it, but you know, we have a Sonoma County Historical Society, which is very active. And every town, burg, hamlet, and crossroad, as well as every other town in Sonoma County, has a historical society. And we don't. And it's, I mean, we didn't. And we do now, and it's time. And thank you all for that.